I'd like to start basic tongue-in-cheek principle given by Anthony Bonetto, and he suggests that once you learn about copes and robbers, you are compelled to prove results about it. So let's see today whether this principle, although this principle is unverifiable, nobody can verify, but let's see today whether this is in force or not today. So this is the outline. Okay. So first I'll give the rules of the game. So the game is played on a simple, undirected and finite graph. And the game starts with the cope choosing a vertex, making its station, and then the robber enters the graph. Now, after that, both copes and robber take alternate turns, starting with the cope. And the cope tries to capture the robber. And the move is defined in a way that every player, cope or robber, can move to a vertex which is adjacent to itself over an edge. So like it can move to a neighboring vertex. And they keep moving. And the winning is defined if cope at some point of time is on the vertex which is already occupied by the robber, or they are at the same vertex at some point, we say that cope has won. So this is the basic game first defined in this manner, where only one cope was there, one robber was there. So this game was originated, first given by A. Quillot in his doctoral thesis in 1978. But for a long time, this game remained unknown to the normal people because the thesis was written in French, and this was pre-internet era. So nobody realized that this game is there. But later, Nowakowski and Winkler independently studied the game in 1983. And they gave a 5-page paper. And that paper is till today the highest cited paper of either authors. So this is a quite good game. People are interested. So, and both try to characterize the cope-win graphs, where one cope will win over the robber. Right, to, yeah, that's a graph parameter, but right now we want to find out the, so they asked the question this way. So they defined a game. This is a copes and robbers game, and they wanted to know what are the graphs where one cope will win, where our cope will win. So they tried to characterize this graph. So we have seen the game. Now we'll see a demo. Okay, and in the prehistory, if we go back in 1917, the book was given, Amusements in Mathematics by Henry. In that he asked a problem, a war puzzle game, in which you don't need to actually read. So he gave that there is a British officer and there is some vigilante, he wants to escape, and that person will he be able to capture that person or not? And it was given in a very specific graph, but nobody realized till a few days back when Anthony Bonetto said that no, actually this is the basic prehistory. So from here it starts. So it dates back to 1917. So let's first take a demo. So this is our arena. Our game started. Our cope comes and places himself on one of the vertices. Now the robber would not like to come to these two vertices because he'll be captured in the next move. So he'd like to come to a safe vertex. So he comes to a safe vertex. Now cope will move, trying to capture. Now robber will try to evade. Now again cope will move, trying to capture. Now here I want to point out that this is a very special condition. Now whatever robber does, he'll be captured in the next cope move. If he stays on the same vertex, he'll be captured by the cope in the next move. If he moves to the vertex, he'll be captured by the next cope move. One thing I forgot to tell, that they don't have to always move. They can skip the move also. Both players can skip the move. So now he chooses to move because he wants to try, but gets captured in the next step. Okay. So now we'll try to characterize the graphs, which are cope-win graphs. So first, we'll define those special vertices. They are defined as corners. So a vertex is corner if there exists another vertex such that, so U is a corner if there exists V such that close neighborhood of U is a subset of close neighborhood of V, which was in this case. So this was a corner. So, and then later it was said that a graph is dismantleable if a sequence of deleting the corners results in a single vertex. And Then the theorem they gave was this, that a graph is Kolpin if and only if this is dismantleable. So just for clearing some things, so this is how they cleared the game. But later more Kolps came. In 1984, Einar and Frome gave this model when there might be more than one Kolps. So initially, K Kolps will come and place themselves on the station themselves on the graph. After that, the rover will come. Now, any number of those K Kolps can move. All K can move, all K can stay, one of them can move, anything can happen. Now, what can happen in this game? So let's look at some of the graphs. So suppose we have a path. So I think it's easy to see that if a Kolp places here, wherever rover comes, after some point of time, he'll capture. Similar thing will happen for trees also. So these are some Kolpin graphs, complete graphs. First, when the Kolp stations itself, in the next move only, there is no safe vertex for the rover. But if we see a four cycle, this is not a Kolpin graph. So if Kolp comes here, rover will come here. So whenever he'll try to move, to capture, he can move to a safe vertex, and this will go on. So now the question arises, how many Kolps for a graph, what you were asking. So what is the minimum number of Kolps that are required to capture a rover on a specific graph? So it's obvious that so there is this dominating set, domination number and dominating set. So dominating set is a set of vertices which, so such that every other vertex, all the vertex is in the close neighborhood set of that dominating set. So if we place a vertex on complete dominating set, rover cannot enter in the graph. So that is a obvious upper bound. So we know that those many Kolps will always do. So now question is, what is the minimum number? In their results, they again tried the Kolpin in a different manner. So they used a different homomorphic, somewhat homomorphic things, which I'll explain in the end if I'll have some time. So their characterization is very beautiful. Now they said one more result. So suppose there is a graph with girth at least 5. So girth is the minimum size cycle. So if there is a graph with girth 5, at least should not be there, girth implies that, and the minimum degree, this delta, then the Kolp number will be more than that delta, more than minimum degree. So this, using this, then they proved that there always exists a graph with any of, like, you give me a Kolp number and I'll construct a graph with that Kolp number. So Kolp numbers are unbounded. So for arbitrarily high Kolp numbers also, there exist graphs. And they later proved that if G is a planar graph, then the Kolp number of that graph is 3. So for the class of planar graphs, Kolp number is 3. And so, okay. Now, how they proved that the Kolp number of planar graphs is 3 is an interesting thing to see. So they said that if there is a shortest path from a vertex U to a vertex V. Jesus. So if there is a shortest path, after some time, Kolp will be able to place itself on this path in a manner such that whenever rover will enter this path, he'll be captured in the next move. So this phenomenon is said to be guarding the path. So how basically they guard the path? They consider all the vertices into some these blocks, D1, D2, DK. And for all vertices, what I'll do, if the distance from V0 for a vertex is I, then I'll put in the block DI. So this is some sort of BF sort of thing. So every vertex in this disk has distance 1 from V0 and so on, goes on. So what I'll do now is that when a rover is in DI, I'll consider the rover to be on VI, the image of the rover, and I'll capture the image of the rover. Now suppose the image of rover is captured on VI. So this is VI, here the image is captured. Now I am saying that whenever he moves to the next some other vertex, I'll always be able to be on the image. because he can move to either this disk or this disk. He cannot move out, because if he can move here, it's a contradiction, this vertex should be here. So he can always move out, but whenever it has to enter the path, it will either enter here or here. So I can always guard a path. I hope it's clear. So they said that you can guard a path. After that, using that thing, they proved that Cope and Rober can win in the planar graph using three Copes. This is also very interesting to see. First Cope, one Cope will guard a shortest UV path. It will choose any UV path and it will guard it. Then another Cope will guard the next shortest path in G minus P1. So suppose this was P1, the next Cope will guard the next shortest path in G minus P1. Now, Rober might be either in this area or that area. But wherever he is, area of the Rober is now restricted. If he is inside, he can't move. If he is on the right side, he can't move to the left. Yes, yes. Basically, I am defining some Rober region, and I am in every step, I am trying to reduce that Rober region. Now, Rober region is defined, and let us assume that he is inside. Now, I'll again divide this Rober region. So, two copes were there, suppose he was inside. Now, the third cope, what he'll do? He'll choose the path in this region, next shortest path, and he'll guard that. And now, since this is a planar graph, if he has to go from this side to this side, he has to go to one of the vertices of the path. And the moment he'll enter the path, he'll be captured. So he can't go to a vertex, and this way he'll again, like he'll go to next vertex, in he'll guard this path, third cope. Now the first cope is free. This cope is free to move. Now he'll move. This way we'll keep restricting, and after some point of time, we'll capture the Rober in a planar graph. If it's not clear, somebody can ask a question.
Sorry, I missed out one point.
Yes, sir.
Is the Rober compelled to move at least?
No, sir. He's not compelled to move. As of now, yes or no.
Can sit in a place.
Can sit in a place and relax, chill.
But
is
the cop who had to run
always? No, sir. He's also, like, right now, the officers are lenient. But officers will get tight in some point of time. There will be a version when the officers will come, oh, no, you have to move. So in that game, things change.
Okay. Some compulsion is there on the other side, but Rober is always in the safe zone.
Rober is always in the safe zone to start.
Does it matter where it starts?
Rober, where does it start, sir? No, the initial position does not matter, because suppose a graph is Cope-Win from a particular situation. This implies wherever the Rober enters, some ways Rober's position matters, sir. Rober's position matters. Suppose there is a safe word, I'll tell you how it matters. Suppose this is a path, this is a four cycle. Cope starts here. If the Rober starts on this side, he'll always be safe. But if he starts from this side, he'll be captured. Cope's initial positions don't matter. But Rober's matters. If he starts on this side, he'll get captured. But if he starts on this side, he'll never be captured using one cope. So three copes somehow capture the Rober on a planar graph. No, this is not the example. In this graph, I don't. Oh, in this graph, yes, I need three copes. In this graph, I need three copes. And indeed, this is the smallest graph where I need three copes. Conjecture to be. We don't. It's a conjecture. It's a conjecture. No. So we'll come to that. Now. Yes, sir, it's written after some point of time. So. Now, these people played this game on the unit disk graph. Now, unit disk graph is also somewhat geometric in shape. So, what they did in unit disk graph, and very interesting thing. So, suppose this is the cope guarding, although he can cross the path. But if I have one cope on its left who is patrolling, one cope on the right who is patrolling, now, whenever he'll cross the path, he'll get captured in the next move. The reason for this is this. Suppose the Rober is somewhere here. This distance and this distance is same. if he means intersects with any of these vertices, this again contradicts the shortest path property. So he has to either cross through this or cross through this, and using the quadrilateral property, we can say that either this or this will capture him the moment he crosses. So again, same thing. Using three cops, I guard a path, patrol a path. Here we say patrolling. Three cops, I patrol. Three cops, I patrol. Keep dividing, keep restricting, and later we'll capture him. So for a unit disk graph, it is known that the cope number will be between 3 and 9. So they tried to construct an example where the cope number 9 is there, but they could not. So they came out with an example where cope number is equal to 3, and it requires at least 1440 vertices. So this is a huge graph, and people strongly believe that the cope number will be less. So no, no, it's easy.
It is constructive.
No. 1440. So there is a repetitive block. So yes, so there is a block, and they keep repeating the block, and they finally. So right now we are trying to tackle this problem. Let's see what happens. Now, on string graphs. Later, this Karthochwil team, they did the same thing in the string graph. They used 5 cops to patrol, and the cope number turned out to be 15. So this is a strong tool. Okay. So what is a string graph? So there are some geometric intersection graphs. What are geometric intersection graphs? That we'll take some geometric objects on the plane. They might be on the like bigger surfaces also, but let's first consider on the plane. So there are some geometric objects. For example, suppose circles. So if they intersect, I'll consider each circle as a vertex. And if they intersect, there is an edge. So this is a basic example.
This will be a planar graph,
right?
No,
this will not be a planar graph.
So
you click.
No, I just say
circles. So, but suppose if I'm saying that you can take any random geometry, any string. String means any geometric object. You might take this. So any string which might be of any order, like you can take squares, you can take anything. If they intersect, I'll put an edge between two objects. If they don't, I will not put. And their intersection graph is a string graph. So this is one curve, yes, sir.
Someone is inside.
No, they don't intersect. Yes, and you can define it any way you want, sir. So, and they said that the cope number will be between 3 and 15. Here also no graph is known where the cope number is more than 3. So now let's come to some conjectures.
So unit disk graph and string graph. So if you improve it for unit disk graph?
String graph is already improved. But the for string. But for string graphs, the example known is very small. Like, I don't think it's more than 15. Like 3 cross 5. 3, 3, 3. Yeah, 15 is easy. With constructing 15 is easy. A 3 cross 5 cylindrical grid have cope number 3.
So this is not a string graph?
Which?
Maybe.
So it was proved in people used to believe that the cope number of this graph is 3. They knew this, but they used to believe that this is the smallest graph. In 2012, Beveridge and other team proved that exactly this is the graph, unigraph, smallest graph with cope number 3, which implies there is no graph which is smaller than this and has the cope number 3. Now there is a conjecture. So smallest unigraph with cope number is equal to k is K5 cage. What is a K5 cage? K5 cage is a k regular graph. Graph with girth 5. So it's a k regular graph with girth 5. So if we put the first lemma that we studied, that if the girth is 5 and the minimum degree is k, then the cope number has to be k. So it is known that they all have cope number k, but are they indeed the smallest? And so for 4-5 is the Robertson graph. That is also believed to be, but that also can't be proved till now. So 4-5 case is the Robertson graph. So it's 4 regular, 5 minimum cycle. So this is Robertson graph. That is Robertson graph. So that actually is Robertson graph. So girth is 5. Girth is 5 and K regular. So it's a K5 cage. And using that lemma, we can see that they will have the Cope number actually equal to K. But are they actually the smallest graphs? Which is conjectured, but nobody knows. Okay, some more conjectures. So we know that for planar graphs, Cope number is 3. Conjecture is this: the dodecahedron is the unique smallest planar graph with Cope number 3. So this is also very sought after. There are some results proved actually about this, which says that if you take any planar graph with 19 vertices, then there will be at least one vertex which can be captured by two copes. So there is no one vertex from where it can always flee. So if you will take one vertex, any 19 vertex planar graph, there will be one vertex when two of the copes are its neighbors. Now it don't have anywhere to flee. But can you trap it there? Like, that's the main question. But nobody knows what will happen. So it is known that no 19, and some more result that if you use some edge contractions and you will make this graph smaller, taking this same graph, that will have Cope number 2. So every subgraph has Cope number 2. Something like that. Some more conjectures. So it is said that it was proved by Stroder that for any graph of genus G, Cope number will be less than equal to 3 by 2 times of G floor plus 3. It was proved. And he also conjectured that Cope number of a graph with genus G will be, in the same paper, will be less than equal to G plus 3. And many big people believe this to be true, and he also believes this to be true. But this conjecture holds for G is equal to 1, the toroidal graphs, but no toroidal graph with Cope number 4 is known. So it is also conjectured that for toroidal graphs, Cope number is 3. So I have a lot of problems, less solutions. Now, since today people are giving solutions, I am giving problems. So now this is the main conjecture, Meniel's conjecture. So Meniel gave this conjecture to Frankel, sent this conjecture to Frankel in writing. This was not published by Meniel, but it was communicated using some personal writing. Then Frankel proved an upper bound. Conjecture says that the Cope number of any graph will be of order square root of n. It cannot be more than order of square root of n. Frankel tried it first, but later after that, it was first tried in 2008. And this was also proved using homomorphisms. Not exactly homomorphisms, retractions. Retraction is a type of homomorphism. So, and later it was proved that it is of order this. If somebody can improve this, everybody is looking after this. So, now, let's come to the game in oriented graphs. What will happen if you play the game on oriented graphs? So arena changes to that graph is connected, finite, the underlying graph, and now we give the edges orientations. Initialization is the same. Moves, now we define two kind of moves. One is a strong move. In a strong move, a player can move along or against the orientations. Like, he can play as if he is playing in the undirected graph. In a weak move, a player can only move along the orientations. He cannot go in the opposite direction of the orientations. And winning is same. Okay. So three obvious models arises. In one, both have strong moves. In one, both have weak moves. Which is undirected, which is gone. So both have weak, one strong weak, weak strong. And the names are also intuitive. In strong cope model, copes can make strong moves. Normal cope model, both can make weak moves. In weak cope model, copes can make weak move while robber can make a strong move. So Nicholas Nisep proposed to characterize Copwin graphs in strong cope model and normal cope model. In Grasta, Grasta is graph searching and graph searching theory and applications. This is a workshop that goes on this particular dedicated to this topic. So we were able to characterize Copwin in weak cope model graphs, and we use the same characterization. Proof is a bit different. So U is a corner vertex in this model. If the out degrees of the U is a corner, if all the neighbor set out degree and in degree is subset of a vertex V's out degree. Now, if we keep deleting these kind of vertices, in the end, if we are left with one vertex or an edge, then we say that graph is Copwin. Otherwise, the graph is not Copwin. But the open problem is that can we use the same kind of some characterization in those two models also? That would be a very good result. So, okay. Now comes the main part. There are a lot of variations on this game we can talk about. So, there's this story that I was actually reading one of the, Anthony Bonato wrote this document saying that conjectures on copes and robbers. In this, he talks about one of his early mentors, latest theorist, Gunter, and he used to tell a story about a mathematician who left the field to become a poet. And the reason why he left was that he did not have enough imagination. So you need more imagination to be a mathematician than to be a poet, according to that person. So mathematicians have weird imaginations. So they came up with weird games. So one of, let's first talk about this model, copes and attacking robber. We had done some work in this model. So right now we are only considering when the cope will move to a vertex occupied by robber. Cope captures the robber. If the opposite thing happens, again cope wins, but this is not a fair game. What happens if cope will move to a vertex occupied by a robber, cope will capture the robber. But if the opposite thing happens, robber moves to a vertex occupied by a cope, robber will eliminate the cope and the game will continue. So this is, now robber has the guns. So now gangs. Now, so in this model, the cope number will be obviously less two times, because if I place two copes at a vertex and use the same
kill only one cope.
Yes, he can kill only one cope. The other cope will capture. So he has to reload the gun somehow. So before he reloads, the other cop kills him. So the next problem is lazy cops and robbers. In lazy cops and robber, this is more realistic. Only one cop will move. Cops are usually lazy only. So in India at least. So one cop will move in a turn. So among the K cops, only one cop will choose and he'll move. He's allowed to move. Now in this game is interesting because the cope number of a graph, which we say that CZ, and this is CL of G, lazy cope number of a graph, can be of order, can be 2 to the power C of G in some cases. So this is the situation. It can be exponential in nature. So that's why people like to study lazy copes and robber. Now as sir was saying, suppose the Inspector General changes and he comes and he says, no, now every cop has to move. Nobody will sit idle, whether you are doing some good or not, but you have to move. So those kind of situations comes, that is said to be hyperactive cops and robber. Now cops are hyperactive. In this model, cops are again penalized, means robber has advantage in this. Now there is this model, zombies and survivors. What happens in, actually every model I am saying is an open problem, because okay, so cops and attacking robber. Cops and attacking robber. And cops and attacking robber is the easier than lazy cops and robber.
But there is no lazy robber.
There is lazy robber, but robber is only one. So
one cannot be lazy, right?
He's only one. He's being lazy or not does not change anything.
Doesn't make difference.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay, so in one cop and robber game, cop is lazy or not does not make any difference, because out of one, one will move.
Okay.
Okay, so it will not make any difference. So there is this game, Zombies and Survivors. What happens in this game? This is a some. This game is in this model. Let's suppose now cops are zombies and robber is a survivor. The roles have changed. So what zombies do? Like they are. So they'll look for their victim, and they'll go on the shortest path available to them. They'll not make smart decisions. So. Till now, whatever we have discussed. So, as I said, you have your own imagination. You come up with your own model. So, anything you can do. So, in this model, suppose we have a circle. And in circle, two cops are enough. One can move from this side, one can move from this side. But suppose this is a zombies and survivor game. So, I have this many zombies. Okay. So, this distance. These are the zombies. Suppose this distance is means for every robot, this distance is favorable. So everybody will move in this direction and he'll keep moving. So even n by 2 minus 2 will always keep following. So they'll not change the direction. So this is a probabilistic model. So the solutions are probabilistic. Question was not probabilistic. Now, recently, Kinnersley gave this model, cops, robbers, and burning bridges. In this model, what robber does? Whenever he'll move over an edge to a new vertex, he'll remove that edge from the game. So whenever he'll cross a bridge, he'll break the bridge in the hope that cop will not be able to use the bridge. So he studied the game, and when you study the game, you realize that this does not always help the robber. So suppose we have a cycle again. So here's the robber, I am the cop. If he never moves, I'll capture him. But the moment he moves, he burned this bridge. Now he can only move in one direction, and I'll capture him. No, he can't, because he has to move in the opposite direction. So now he can move in only one direction, deleting the edges.
Okay.
What you said, now in grids we know, what you said is very right, actually. In grids, we know the cop number is 2. It's folklore. That in grid scope number is 2, which is very easy to see also. Using the first principle, we said, I'll guard this path. Now, I'll guard this path. Now, second cop will guard this path. And he can keep moving, and he'll capture. So in grids, the cope number is 2. But suppose we are playing this game, burning bridges. So he takes a vertex. He moves this side, this side, this side, this side. This side, this side, this side, this side. Yes, this is what he was saying. So he can burn, if he can move 8 times before cop can capture him, the graph is disconnected, and he will not be able to capture him ever. So this is one. Now fully active cops and robber. In this model, cops and robbers are both always active. This is everybody has to move. Now this is cops, robber, and robber. Okay. Now in this case, suppose robber has to always move in grid. The cop number changes to 1. If robber has to always move, the cop number changes to 1. So being active is not always a good thing. So now this is model, cops and robber without recharging. Yes, yes. And cops have bikes, but their bikes have limited amount of fuel. It will run out. So you have to capture the robber before your fuels run out. So you put it in a better way than I could, in the way I could think, and so on. Yes, sir. Lazy? I told lazy. Lazy cops and robber.
No, no. The cop catches the robber, the robber climbs and
runs. Yes, sir. Douglas B. West gave a model in which the game of spies and revolutionaries, something like this. So there are spies. So every kind of model exists. The kind that does not exist, you can come out with.
The problem will be the robber has robbed some key amount of money.
Yes. Yes, yes.
So how many times he can afford
before he really caught? Yes. So he has to rob as much as possible before getting captured. So these are the models I can think of. And if that model, what you were talking, that I didn't prepare to tell. In that model, you were saying, actually, when cope, everything is actually initially dark. Now, cope enters a vertex, robber enters a vertex. whenever cope will move from this vertex brightens up. Now it's in the visibility range. When Robert will come here, it's still bright. But whenever he'll move out, now it goes dark. Now you have to capture. There is one more model I'd like to tell, and then I'll shut down.
But the cop is aware of the problem, right?
No. No, in this model, everything is dark initially. So cop does not know. So now there is a model with limited visibility. Suppose you can see only K neighborhood of yours. Now how the game will proceed. Suppose now Robert has more speed. What will happen now? Suppose cops have helicopters. Suppose cops have light radars. So there is this model. Cops have radars. So radars placed, he cannot see everything, but he has some radars in the vicinity. So whenever the robot will come into the radar region, he'll know the position. Now what he'll do, means using that information, what he can do. So dynamic modeling. So visibility, all these models are there. There is this model. So there are random graph models also. In random graph models, what happens is that it's a Markov chain now. In Markov chain, you have to go, you will go to the vertex and the cope number goes to 1 with some high probability. So that's that model is called Copes and Drunk Robber. So in the visibility graphs, this person, LUBIW, recently proved that in, so it came in 2018, and they said, so they claim that for the visibility graph, scope number is 1. I have not read the paper, so I don't know how they did it, because I looked at the paper very recently. So the cope number of this graph is 1. In the normal geometric graphs, suppose we have a polygon with some holes, and suppose we divide the area in, he can move from here to here, like some discrete amount, because people move in discrete amount. So the cope number goes to 3, equal to planar graphs. This is a very old paper. Maybe you are talking about this.
I was talking about something else. I think I'll check this.
Okay, sir. And the cope number of any polygons is 3. Okay. Just like planar graph, same technique is used. So there is this model I'd like to talk about. So this I have seen recently. So this was termed as rabbit and hunter game. What happens in this model? Suppose there is a rabbit, every vertex is a bush. And a rabbit is hidden behind a bush. So now hunter can't see him. So he's like a sniper. So he'll aim at a bush and will shoot at the bush. Whenever he'll shoot at the bush, if it kills the rabbit, he knows immediately. But if the rabbit is not killed, the moment he got shot, he will jump to one of its neighbors. So how the game will proceed? In this model, we know that on path, one hunter can always kill a robber. So this goes like this. First, he'll shoot the even vertices. Then he'll shoot the odd vertices. So by some calculations, we can make sure that either he's first time I'll go on even, then I'll go on odd, and he'll got killed in the middle way. But this on grids, this changes to a lot. Like they are very big bounds. Small bound and a lower bound, upper bound, there is a big difference. So if somebody is interested, these are all the models I have. You can come up with your own. Thank you.
This area looks like have more problems than the number of solutions.
Yes, sir. Everybody have a problem, sir. Today only we came up with one to solve rest of the problems. So if we can come up with your bribe model, and if we could solve some of the problems, which are relatively easy, we can publish a paper and let other people find out what about the hard problems. So.
Honest cop and lazy robber. This seems to be the easiest. Honest cops and lazy robber is the simplest problem. Okay, I think we have enough.
Thank you.